Good morning. Welcome to church. Serving Jesus. Giving him glory. I'm so glad that you're here this morning. I'm glad that you're here joining us online. It is cold in Enid, Oklahoma this morning. It may be cold outside, but we are hot and warm in our hearts. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Wow, it's Thanksgiving weekend or week coming up. What a great time. Everybody ready for Thanksgiving? A few of you? Nope. Hey, let's turn in our attention to the wall and let's make our confessions this morning. Join me if you would. I'm a believer. I am not a doubter. The Word works in me. And at this moment, I humble myself under the mighty hand of God. I cast all my cares over on Him. From this moment forward, I refuse to worry. Instead, I will pray. I will use my faith and believe, and He'll exalt me over the problem and over the devil. For I belong to Jesus, and He cares for me. I'm a believer, and I'm not a doubter. The Word works in me. I live by faith. The Lord has anointed me to preach the gospel and to heal the sick. I am born again. I am healed. I am baptized in the Holy Ghost. I pray in the Spirit. I walk in His abundance. I am strong, for He is my strength. I am highly favored of the Lord and man. I'm a believer. I'm not a doubter. The Word works in me. I choose to rejoice double today. I demonstrate a gentle spirit to all men. Thank you, God, for being near. I'm not anxious about anything, but I am thankful, and I let my requests be known to God. I live in the peace of God, and it guards my heart and my mind in Christ Jesus. I choose to dwell on those things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Amen. Father, we come this morning. We're just here to be in your presence, Lord. We've come, Father, to minister to you and to minister to each other. Lord, I pray that each person walked in this place today ready to exhort, ready to encourage, ready to comfort each other. Lord, truly as the church, we come together to love you, to love each other, to have a new connection, a fresh connection, to help build each other up in our most holy faith, praying in the Spirit and living according to the Word. Father, we gather here today to be refreshed, to be equipped, to stand in your grace and your anointing. We worship you today, God. All around us, there are things, Lord, that try to distract us, try to get us off base, try to take us into doubt and fear and worry. Lord, we choose to stand today in your presence, in your Spirit, in your love. We worship you, Jesus. We adore you, God. We ask you to be in this place. Walk with us today, Father. Draw us into your Spirit. Lord, we worship you. We give you praise, Lord. We worship you. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you. Lord, I thank you for the grace, the anointing, the love that we sense right now, Lord. Just as we begin, thank you. Thank you for the love you give us. We worship you, Lord. We honor you. Receive our praise. Let it be a sweet offering into your presence this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship Jesus, Thomas.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place. You would bear my cross. For all that you've done for me. Who brings the chaos back into order? Who makes an orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, who's in the sun, all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place. You would bear my cross. This is unfair.
presence, Lord. We are undone. In your presence, nothing about us matters. It's all you. We just stand where heaven and earth meets, Lord, and we come together in your presence. We stand in awe of you. You are majesty. You are glorious. You are beautiful. Your love is amazing. And we stand, Lord, undone, completely exposed to you. Everything we are, everything that's not Jesus, Lord, we want all that to be burned up. We want to stand before you pure and holy. Lord, empty us. Empty us of self. Empty us of self, Lord. Just let it be you. We worship you. We worship you. We stand, Lord, in awe. Thank you. In your presence. in your presence, Lord. In your presence, we are refreshed. In your presence, we're renewed. In your presence, God. Jesus. We worship you. In your presence. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Restoration and healing today, God. Restore hearts today. Restore bodies today. In your presence is the fullness of joy. In your presence, we give you thanks. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus.
Father, we thank you for the refreshing of your Spirit this morning. Thank you for healing, Lord, setting people free. Thank you, God, for direction, where you've spoken to people's hearts and you've given them answers, Lord, where they've been looking. Gave them direction. You gave them understanding. Father, I praise you. We worship you, Jesus, in your presence is the fullness of joy. Thank you. Thank you for that joy. Lord, we worship you. We worship you, God. We worship you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We worship you. Now bless somebody by you. Don't ask about anything, but just bless them. Bless them. Somebody close to you, just speak blessing into their life. Invoke blessing, the Bible says. Invoke blessing, the Bible says. So bless somebody. Bless somebody. Bless somebody this morning. Bless them in Jesus' name. Bless them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Spirit of God is strong. All right, go ahead and grab your Bibles. Let's just jump in the Word. You're going to need pen and paper. I've got some questions for you this morning. It's Thanksgiving week. Talk a little bit about giving thanks. Well, I moved the chairs again, just a little. Not quite as drastic as last time. But it gives you just kind of a little better, kind of a little closer, a little more family atmosphere, I think. Thank you, Lord. All right, so grab pen and paper. I'm going to ask you some questions as we get started. If you're watching online, we're so glad that you're here. We want you to answer these questions too. Now, don't say it out loud. Just write them down or answer the questions, and we'll see how good your knowledge is this morning. Scriptural knowledge. Let's take a look at that. All right, question number one. What's the shortest chapter in the Bible? Write it down. Shortest chapter in the Bible. Write it down. If you need a pen, raise your hand. We'll get you a pen. Shortest chapter in the Bible. Whew. All right, second question. What's the longest chapter in the Bible? Shortest chapter, the longest chapter. Write them down. Think, what does this have to do with teaching? You're going to see here in a few minutes. Everybody have their answers? Now, don't Google it. That's not fair. Everybody have their answers? All right, so just if you know what's the shortest chapter in the Bible, raise your hand. Three of you. What is it? Right there, Dustin, what is it?
Huh? Not the shortest verse, shortest chapter. Go ahead, Sue. Psalms 117. Psalms 117 is the shortest chapter in the Bible. It's got two verses. Now, let me ask you this. What's the longest chapter in the Bible? Raise your hand if you know. Longest chapter. Everybody should know that one. Anybody? Psalms 119. Very good. Now, let me ask you a third question. What's the center chapter of the Bible, the exact center? There's 594 chapters behind it. There's 594 chapters ahead of it. What's the exact center chapter in the Bible? Does anybody know? Go ahead, Brenda. Psalms 118. Psalms 118. Shortest chapter, Psalms 117. Longest chapter, Psalms 119, and the center chapter is Psalms 118. Psalms 118 is where I'm going to be teaching out of today. That's kind of why I threw out those for you, because you won't ever forget that. Now let me ask you this. What is the center verse, the exact verse that's smack dab in the center of everything? You obviously know it's going to be in Psalms 118. Does anybody have any idea what that verse is? Let's see if anyone knows. Nope, it's not 18. Here we go. Ready? The center verse of the Bible is verse 8 of Psalms 118. Let's look at it. Jonathan, put it on the board, please. Father, in Jesus' name, minister to us today. Let our hearts be refreshed. Let us grow in understanding and knowledge. Lord, draw us into a depth of understanding of the importance of giving thanks and blessing you and blessing others. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Watch this. Here's the verse. Ready? It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. That's the center. Now, I think that's a pretty powerful verse to be the center of the Bible. You know, when you think about it, if you're building something and you want everything to be what they call plumbed, then you have to make sure everything is straight. All the studs have to be straight, all the boards, everything has to be straight. And so you center it. And the way you center it is you use a level. You take that level and you put it up there and you make sure that little bubble is right where it's supposed to be. This verse right here will level you. If you will take this verse to heart, it will level you out. Think about it. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. The word refuge means this: put yourself under their care. So it's better to put yourself under the care of God than to trust in man, no matter who it is. No matter who it is. I'm going to teach you today a key of how to make sure that you are taking refuge in the Lord. The children of Israel came out of Egypt. Moses went in. You know, they'd been in there 400 years. Moses went in and said, God wants you to come out for this purpose. And this is what he told Pharaoh. He said, God said to let my people go. Let them go to where they can worship God. That was the whole intent, to get them out of Israel, was for them to have opportunity to worship God. Pharaoh said no. 12 plagues later, lots and lots of death in the Egyptian nation, the children of Israel are released to go do what? Worship God. And in Exodus chapter 15, you will find, and I think I mentioned this a little last week, but you will find in Exodus 15 one of the greatest worship times in history. In fact, years ago, there used to be a song that we used to sing in church. How many of you have been in church long enough to remember that old song, "The Horse and the Rider Thrown into the Sea"? It was a chorus that we used to sing. It goes, "I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and the rider are thrown into the sea." And that's taken exactly out of Exodus chapter 15, because the children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, they begin to worship the Lord. The Bible says that Miriam, who is Moses' sister, that she grabbed banners, she grabbed scarves, she grabbed the women, and they begin to dance. They jumped, they shouted. Now let me ask you something. If your family had been in slavery for 400 years, and all of a sudden God opened the door and your family was able to walk out of slavery, but they didn't walk out of slavery poor, they walked out of slavery rich. They walked out with the possessions of Egypt. And they got over the Red Sea, and the Red Sea destroyed the army. If you had been in that family and knew the history of your family for 400 years, how many of you would be jumping up and down, shouting, screaming, yelling, twisting, twirling, throwing banners, throwing your kids up, shouting, giving God glory, giving victory? See, those are the things that were happening in Exodus chapter 15. There was an excitement in the land of Israel. There was an energy. And God was in the center of it. Kind of like what we felt this morning in his presence. Now, the problem that happened after that is listen, they celebrated for over 3 days. Would you like to have a three-day party? Some of you are getting ready to do that, aren't you? But I don't know how much celebrating Jesus there might be. There might be a lot of celebrating football in Turkey, but let's hope in that celebration that you celebrate Jesus in the middle of it. But for 3 days, they worshiped God. They gave him glory. Why? All because of that verse. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. Now watch what happened after that. And this is part of your homework. Go home and read Exodus chapter 15. You'll see what happened. But what happened after that is, after that party got over, immediately they had no water. And they begin to complain and gripe and murmur. God had just destroyed the army of Egypt, and they thought that, and they even said to Moses, "Well, you brought us out here to die. Why didn't you just leave us there?" What happened was, immediately, watch this, they begin to trust in man, in their own ability, in their own strength, in their own thought pattern, in their own belief system. How many of you know some of us have got a screwed up belief system? Because it's not a scriptural belief system, but it's a man-made belief system. And some of us need to have our belief system completely tore apart and rebuilt. But because of their belief system, listen, they may not have had it very good in Egypt, but at least they had a home that they were in. At least they had food, sort of. They worked hard. They were beat. They were put down. And they were ready to go back to that, all because they got their eyes off of the refuge of God into the eyes of self. And for 40 years, they wandered in the wilderness. And you think it was because of what happened when they went into the promised land and came out with the spies. Oh, that had a lot to do with it. But see, that period of time between the Red Sea and getting over to the Promised Land affected what happened in the Promised Land. Because they weren't thinking properly. So in Psalms 118, I want you to look here because I want you to see the story of the psalmist here and what he teaches us here and how we're supposed to live. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. Verse 1 says this, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. How many of you think God is good? Yeah, you know, a lot of times somebody says God is good, and someone says all the time, and someone says all the time, God is good. But, you know, those can simply become a cliche and words that run out of our mouth but have no substance or meaning to them. But this psalmist is writing here saying, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Now watch this. For his loving kindness is everlasting. That word loving kindness means this, mercy, goodness, and faithful. How many of you are thankful for God's mercy? See, it's his mercy that allows you to be part of the kingdom of God. It's his goodness, his faithfulness that allows you from being destroyed. Now, I want you to watch this. I want you to underline that phrase, for his loving kindness is everlasting, because you're going to see it about four times in this chapter. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Oh, let Israel say, go ahead. Oh, let Israel say, yeah. Are you part of Israel? Yeah. So what should you be saying? His loving kindness is everlasting. See, when you wake up in the morning, Father, thank you for the day that you've given to me. I give you praise because your loving kindness is everlasting. Your mercy, your goodness, your faithfulness, it's everlasting. What does everlasting mean? Without stop, without end, will never fail. Look at verse 3. Oh, let the house of Aaron say, his loving kindness is everlasting. The house of Aaron were the leaders. If you're a leader in this house, what should you be saying? Say it again, Jonathan. I don't think anyone heard you. If you're a leader in this house, what should you be saying? His loving kindness is everlasting. And then he says, oh, let those who fear the Lord. How many of you fear God? What does fear God mean? Simply, Proverbs 8:13 says, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. How many of you hate evil? Yeah, that's what we're supposed to do. So he says, oh, let those who fear the Lord say, his loving kindness is everlasting. Mercy, goodness, and faithfulness is everlasting. Verse 5 says, from my distress, how many of you ever feel distressed? From my distress, I called upon the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in a large place. In other words, he moved you up. He put you in a better place. He increased you. He gave you a promotion. Gave you a new job. Gave you a new place. He gave you something new. You called upon the Lord in your distress. Listen, too many times in our distress, instead of calling upon the Lord, we want to complain to the Lord. I can't believe you let me go through this again. Here we go, just like always. Anybody ever say those kind of things? See, sometimes, church, we're in the situation we're in because of what comes out of our mouth. In my distress, I called upon the Lord. The Lord answered me and said in a large place. What do you think when it says he called upon the Lord? What do you think he called upon the Lord? What did he ask? What did he say to the Lord? Say it again, Jonathan. Your loving kindness is everlasting. Lord, I look to you and I know your loving kindness is everlasting. And in the middle of this distress, I need you. And I know your loving kindness is everlasting. Lord, I need you. And he calls upon the Lord. Verse 6 says, the Lord is for me. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Listen, man can hurt your physical outward body, but they cannot steal your spirit. They might kill your body, but they cannot kill who you are. And Paul said to be absent from this body is to be present with Jesus. So what if they destroy your body? If you're a believer in Jesus, where are you at? I get to be in heaven. As they stoned Stephen and threw rocks of big proportion upon him, and his body was being pounded with these rocks, he looked up to heaven and he said, "Look, I see the Son of God, and he's standing up next to the Father. Welcome me home." Think about it. If you can see that, I don't think you can feel the rocks beating on you. I think you've already made that step over going, "In my distress, I called out to the Lord, and he took me to a large place." And for Stephen, that large place was heaven. For Paul, he got stoned 3 times. For Paul, it was God raised him up from the dead and he came out of the stones. You know, about the second time I began, "God, are you kidding? You want to raise me up again? Can I just come home?" No, Paul's like, "My race isn't over. I've got to finish the race." But there's something here, church, about the fact that we learn how to worship God. Verse 7 says, "The Lord is for me among those who help me. Therefore, I will look with satisfaction on those who hate me." Got anybody that hates you? Got anybody that doesn't like you? Got anybody that thinks you're a bad person? Got anybody who treats you horrible, who persecutes you? What are you supposed to do at? Look at them with peace. Look at them with satisfaction. Because when you do that, you understand the verse 8. I'm not taking refuge in you. I'm not trusting in you. I've put my refuge in God, and God is my mercy, my goodness, my faithfulness, and he will carry me through. And so I can look at you in satisfaction because you can't hurt me. You can't take from me. You may take every earthly good I have, but God will replace it 7 times over. So we've got to begin to understand what Scripture says and what God promises to us. It says if the enemy steals from you and you catch an enemy, he has to pay you back 7 times what's been stolen. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. What's the first thing he came to do? Steal. He's a thief. What's he have to do? Replace it 7 times. So if you feel like that something has been stolen away from you, begin to walk around in satisfaction that, "Lord, you are faithful, you show me mercy, you show me goodness, and the thing that has been stolen from me has to be replaced 7 times. 7 times. I don't think you're listening. Verse 8, "It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man." Verse 9, "It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in government." Isn't that what that says? It's better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in a political party. I mean, that's what you could say there. It's better to take refuge in the Lord. In fact, Lord, thank you for the Democratic Party. Thank you for the Republican Party. Thank you that they don't control my life because I take refuge in you. Thank you that they don't control the economics of this world because you control my economics. And I thank you that I put my refuge in you, and I'm the head, not the tail. I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed coming out. Lord, I thank you that everything I put my hand to prospers. Lord, I thank you that you have called me. You have blessed me. You've equipped me, Lord, you give me power to make wealth. See, we don't have to worry about the princes when our refuge is in the Lord. We don't have to worry about the government. You got to think about this. When Jesus was alive on earth, Israel was under the control of the Roman army. Do you think the Roman army was gentle to them? No. And Jesus just kept on putting refuge in God. So it doesn't matter what's happening around you. When we learn to put refuge in the Lord, he will take care of us. Verse 10, all nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I will surely cut them off. You know, there were times, and it does not say who wrote this psalm. You know, a lot of psalms are written by King David. It does not say who wrote this one. But you think about how King David was many times surrounded by armies, and God always gave him a way of escape. Always. And you can think about the children of Israel when they went into the promised land and they began to fight cities. God always gave them the plan to win. Listen, God did not create you to lose. God created you to be an overcomer. Overcomers are winners. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm a winner. Go ahead. Now look at your neighbor with authority. Say, I'm a winner. I'm a believer, I'm not a doubter. The Word works in me, and if the Word works in me, I'm an overcomer. I am victorious. I'm the head and not the tail. I am a winner. Now turn to your neighbor and say it with power. I'm a winner. They surrounded me. The nations, watch this, verse 11, they surrounded me. Yes, they surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I will surely cut them off. Listen, I think part of the problem that we have today is that people have forgot the authority that they have in the name of Jesus Christ. We have authority. Begin to take that authority. If you don't believe me, look at Matthew 28 and Mark 16, the last part of each chapter. You look at both of those, and Jesus said, I've given you power, I've given you authority after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it says that you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. You shall be endued with power. That word endued means overtaken with power. And then when you read Acts chapter 2, verse 4, when the Holy Ghost came upon them, it said that it was like cloven tongues of fire that set upon them. And it wasn't a little bit light that came upon their head. It was a fire that engulfed them and wrapped itself around them. The Holy Ghost wrapped around each person, and they became endued with power. We have been given authority by Holy Spirit. We've been given authority by the blood of Jesus Christ. We've been given authority by Father God, and we should never walk in defeat. We should always walk in victorious attitude. Even when everything around us looks like it's been defeated, we can always turn and say, my refuge is in you, and you are merciful, you are goodness, and you are faithful, and I am an overcomer. Thank you, God. See, we're going into Thanksgiving to eat a turkey. You should be going into Thanksgiving ready to give thanks to God for where He's brought you today. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. He's talking about the nations. Look at verse 12. I love this. They surround me like bees, and they are extinguished as a fire of thorns. You ever had bees coming at you? Look at this. They surrounded me like bees, but they were extinguished as the fires of thorns. Here came the fire. My enemies were destroyed. Here it came. Listen, church, we've got to learn. Listen, this is the psalmist writing before the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is before Holy Spirit was poured out. They walked in authority in the Old Testament because they understood the Old Covenant. We have a new and a better covenant through Jesus by Holy Spirit. We need to understand our authority, walk in it, declare it, speak it, live it, let it take a hold of our life, and allow God to produce through us. It's this right here that gets us into trouble. It's this right here that gets us into trouble. We've got to change it. They pushed me violently so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. There's no one better to help you get up than God. They pushed me violently so I was falling. But the Lord helped me. Get my hand. Grab my hand. You're not pushing Him down.
Get behind me. Stand behind me. Come on. Come at me. Because you can't get to him. See, that's what God does when we understand that God is our refuge. God is our refuge. Verse 14. The Lord is my strength. When's the last time you said, God, thank you for my strength? Go ahead, say it. Look at your neighbor and say, God is my strength. Now look to heaven and say, God, thank you that you are my strength. And my song. Thank you, Lord, that you put a song in me. Listen, I can tell you now, if you don't have joy in your heart, if you don't have a song bubbling up inside of you, it's because you forgot how to worship God. You have forgot how to give thanks to God. And you got to start giving thanks. Thank you, Lord. How many of you just took a breath? None of you took breaths? How many of you just took a breath? Did you thank God for your breath? Thank you, Lord, that I'm breathing. Thank you, Lord, that you made me awake. Thank you, God, that you've given me fresh air. Thank you, Lord, that I don't have to walk around wearing oxygen today because you've blessed my lungs. Thank you, God, that I don't have to walk around in a wheelchair. Not that that's wrong, but I don't have to be there because why? God's my healer. God's my strength. God's my deliverer. God's my freedom. Thank you, God. Thank you that you are my strength. And verse 15, I don't even know what to do with 15. The sound of joyful shouting. The sound of joyful shouting. The sound of joyful shouting. I told you weren't listening. The sound of joyful shouting. Okay, we'll stay there. The sound of joyful shouting. Let me. Have you ever walked into the grocery store and you wanted to get a particular item and you walked up and it's half price? Oh, yeah, look at that. There's a shopper, yeah. The joy, the sound of joyful shouting and salvation is in the tents of the righteous. Let me ask you this. How many of you are righteous? How many of you are righteous? What should be happening in your house? Should be what? Joyful shouting. Joyful shouting. Tomorrow morning, who gets up first in your house? Who wakes up first? You. Tomorrow morning when you get up, Jack, you should just wake up and go, yeah, and see what happens. The joyful shout. The joyful shout is. What is is? What does is mean? What does is mean? It means it's there. The joyful shout is in the tent of the righteous. How many of you are righteous? So what should be going on in your house? There should be a joyful shout. Lord, I thank you for the joy of the Lord because I know that the joy of the Lord is my strength. Because the verse before that says the Lord is my strength. And I know the joy of the Lord is my strength. So because the Lord has given me joy, I just need to shout about it. Thank you for joy. I'm just waiting to get reports of what happens tomorrow morning. You're not going to believe what he did. Yes, I am. It's all right, Catherine, you do it first. Better yet, wake each other up and shout together. How about that? See how that would be? How would that be? Hey, you got a minute? Let's wake up. Let's shout for the joy of the Lord. And if you live alone, you know what? If you live alone, call somebody you know on the phone.
Hey, I got to tell you, I've got the shout of the Lord inside of me today. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The sound of joyful shouting and salvation is in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. What does valiantly mean? What does valiantly mean? Look it up. This is one time you should Google something. What does valiantly mean? Say it again. What does valiantly mean? I'm going to let one of you look it up. What is it? With courage or determination, right? Watch this. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly, or the right hand of the Lord with determination will carry you through. The right hand of the Lord, He is determined to see you through. The Lord is determined to see you through. Listen, some of you need to hear this morning. The Lord is determined to see you through. The Lord's determined to see you through. Doesn't matter what the doctor says about that finger. You got 9 more to worship God with. If they take it off, who cares? But we believe God is going to restore it before they take it off. But God is determined to see you through. God's determined to see you through. No matter what's going on in your life, He is determined. And let me tell you what, there's nobody better to be determined than God. You ever had one of your children that went through a situation and suddenly you got determined? Yeah, I see that out on the sport field all the time. Parents get determined that they're going to make things right. God is determined to make things right for you. God is determined. Some of you need to write that down. God's determined to see me through it. Now watch this. Verse 17 says, I will not die but live and tell the works of the Lord. That should become a verse that I'm not dying. I shall live and not die and declare the wonders of the Lord. I shall live and not die and declare the wonders of the Lord. But listen, you can't claim that verse, I shall live and not die, unless you're going to declare the wonders of God. That's giving thanks. Thank you, God. Do you see how important it is to give thanks? Children of Israel quit giving thanks and they started murmuring and complaining. And what did God do? He said, okay, that's it. That generation, you've lost the promised land. You get to die in the wilderness. I think sometimes people are going through their wilderness because they won't worship God and they're doing it to themselves. It's not anything God's doing. They're bringing it upon themselves. I will live and not die and declare the glory of God. Now, verse 18 says this, and this is the one nobody likes. The Lord has disciplined me severely. How many of you think you need a spiritual spanking sometimes? Yeah, Dustin's like, yeah, I need a bunch of them. The Lord has disciplined me severely. We don't want to talk about that kind of stuff. But we've got to learn how to worship God even in the discipline. Lord, I don't like what's going on right now. I don't like the correction I'm in right now, but I'm going to worship you for it because I know that you know what's good for me and you're going to take me through it. Thank you, God. But watch this. But He's not giving me over to death. Aren't you thankful that God just didn't give up on you and say, just go ahead and die? Go ahead and die. I'm done with you. Thank goodness He didn't say that. Open to me the gates of righteousness, and I shall enter through them, and I shall give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous will enter through it. I shall give thanks to you, for you have answered me, and you have become my salvation. What is it? What is the gate of the Lord? Watch this. Verse 21, the stone which the builders rejected
has become the chief cornerstone. Who's the stone that the builders rejected? Jesus. And he became the chief cornerstone. And the writer here is saying, open to me the gate of righteousness. How many of you know that Paul says that I am the righteousness of God in who? Christ Jesus. So he says, open up the gate of righteousness, and I shall enter through them, and I'll give thanks to the Lord. How many of you have given thanks today for God being your righteousness? Lord, thank you that I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I thank you that you have made me righteous. I don't have to work for it. It's not something I have to earn. You have made me righteous, and I thank you for it. Even in my failures, even when my flesh gives in to the flesh, my spirit is righteous. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you for giving me a gate that I could walk through that brings me to righteousness, and that gate is Jesus. Thank you, Lord. How many of you have given thanks for Jesus today? Watch this. Verse 23. This is the Lord's doing. This is what God is doing. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made. What day has the Lord made? Now watch this. We all say this. This is the Lord, the day is made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. You've heard that verse, right? And everyone says, okay, I'm going to rejoice because this is the day. And we're talking about today. Do you know what day Jesus is talking, or what day God's talking about here? The day of the gate. The day that Jesus, that God opened the gate through Jesus. This is the day that the Lord has made. I've opened a gate, and you are welcome to walk through it. Let us rejoice and be glad in this day that God has made. The date when I opened the gate, and you can walk through it. Yeah, should we be thankful for this day? Yes, but we need to give thanks for the day that God opened that gate and said, come on in. Come on in. This is the day the Lord has made, the date the gate was open that you can enter into. O Lord, do save, we beseech you. O Lord, we beseech you, do send prosperity. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. Now what is all that talking about? See, when we understand the gate, when we understand that the gate has been opened and we have a passageway. I talked about this Wednesday night in Bible study. Listen, why did Jesus come to this earth? Tell me why Jesus came. To seek and save that which was lost. Okay, what else? Let me ask you this. How many of you think that Jesus came so you could get born again? No, see, Jesus came for this reason. Jesus came to open the gate and create a pathway to get man back to the Father. That's why he came. That's what redemption is, to get us back to the Father. Jesus came, and the gate was open to get man back to the Father. Now, do you know why the Holy Spirit came? Do you know why Jesus sent Holy Spirit? So he could teach you how to walk that pathway to get to the Father. It's pretty simple. Jesus said, it is expedient that I go away. But if I go, I will send another to you. And he will be a teacher, and he will bring to your remembrance all that I've taught you. What is he going to teach them? How to get on the pathway, stay on the pathway, be successful through the pathway all the way to the Father. That's what the Holy Spirit's doing. Jesus came to give us a pathway. Holy Spirit came to walk us through the pathway. And the Father's waiting for us to come. Wow. What a great plan. Thank you, God, for your plan of redemption. Thank you, God. Do you see why it's important that we give thanks? Do you see why it's important that we bless him and bless each other? It is important that we become people of thanksgiving, not just this week, but every week. We're people of thanksgiving. We're people that bless. We're people that give honor. We're people who love him and praise him. Thank you, Lord. I got 45 seconds. I'm going to hold you a little bit, sorry. The Lord is God, and he has given us light, verse 27. Bind the festival sacrifice with cords to the horn of the altar. You are my God, and I give thanks to you. You are my God, and I extol you. You give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his loving kindness is everlasting. How many of you believe you need to give thanks to God today? Amen. Thank you, Lord. And we're going to give thanks today in a special way. Tom, would you bring that stuff? We're going to take communion as a church. And we're going to give thanks to God. Jesus said to the disciples, as often as you drink of this cup and eat of this bread, do it in remembrance of me. Just bring it right up here and set it up here. Do it in remembrance of me. And what are we doing when we remember Jesus? We're giving him thanks. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, guys. We're giving him thanks. So today, as we head into the Thanksgiving weekend, or the Thanksgiving week, I just really thought it would be appropriate to take communion together as a family, as a body, and to give God thanks and remember what he did. So here's what I want you to come, and I want you to get a cup and go back to your seat. Take bread with you. And I don't, you know those, I don't do the unleavened bread because that was a Jewish custom and I'm not under the law anymore. And I like sweet bread, so I brought Hawaiian bread. So I want you to come and I want you to get a piece of bread and just, you know, take a chunk because you're going to need a chunk. You don't need a little bitty piece. So come get a cup and you might need two of them. But go ahead, come on. Come get a cup and get some bread. And then just take it back to your chair with you and don't take it yet. Here's your bread. All right, just grab a piece of bread, take a cup. You can take it, that's fine. There's more, but you got to eat the whole bread. Now, you remember I said you might want to take two cups. I don't know why, but you might. Depends on. You're about to spill both of them. Just take one. You only need one, I promise. All right, take them both. Don't spill them. You can sit down once you get your bread and cup. Huh? Now, don't lick it or do anything with it because I'm going to have you do something with it, so be kind. Just hold it. Teresa, come up here, please. Everybody have bread? Everybody have a cup? So here's what I want you to do with your bread and your cup. I want you to take it, and I want you to bless somebody with it. And I want you to say something of blessing to them. And I give you an example. I'm thankful that God put you in my life. Why are you grinning? I'm thankful that God put you in my life because you challenge me in lots of ways that I need to be challenged. And I love you. And I give you this. Go ahead. You can go back to, you don't have to give me yours. You can do what you want with yours. Find someone to give your cup away to. And they don't have to give theirs to you. They may want to give it to someone else. But find someone and bless them and give your cup away to them. Huh? Okay. Cup and bread. Bless them. Give them both.
Yes.
All right, now once you've done that, Jesus said that he took the bread and he gave thanks. Did you hear that? He took the bread and he gave thanks. And that didn't mean, Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this bread. Bless it to the nourishing. That's not what he meant. He gave thanks. Father, thank you. Thank you for life. Thank you for the blessings. I give thanks today. See, that's what Jesus did. So take a moment. Now that you've received bread from someone else, give God thanks and eat of the bread. Thank you, God. If you're watching at home, participate. If you don't have anyone at home, go out and grab a neighbor. Drag them in. Say, here's bread. Bless them. Father, thank you for the blood of Jesus that gives us authority and power. Thank you for giving us a life of overcoming. Change us, Holy Spirit. And where we need to be corrected, correct us. And help our heart to be open to your correction. And we receive it in Jesus' name. Thank you for the blood. Amen. Take the blood, take the juice. Thank you, Lord. Now just close your eyes. And in whatever manner you want to express your love to the Father, give him thanks. Go ahead, thank him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And let me encourage you this week. Before you cut into that turkey, before you grab any yams, take time to bless the Lord as a family. Take time to honor God. Take communion together. See, I've never done that. Start a new tradition. Take communion as a family and give thanks to God for what he's done. Amen. Thank you, Lord. We're going to take our offering real quick. If you're watching online, we want you to give. We want you to be part. alife.church. Go on and hit give. Or right there on Facebook, hit give now. Or you see the text number on there. You can text and it'll take you in and show you how to give. We want you to be a part of this ministry. If you're here in this sanctuary, be responsible to be a part of the ministry God's put in your life. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to worship you and to bless you. So many people are hurting this year, God, going through things in their lives where they feel like they're being pulled and feel like they're being destroyed. And I'm asking you, Father, this week, that you will use us to speak life into them by our rejoicing, our thanks, our praise. It will minister hope to them, God. I thank you for doing it. I honor you today. Lord, we receive the offering this morning and the tithes, but I thank you that on earth man receives them. But in heaven you receive them and you apply them to people's accounts. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, go ahead. We will not have Bible study Thursday or Wednesday night, day before Thanksgiving. Enjoy your time with your family. Be back here Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Have a wonderful time in the Lord. We love you and appreciate you. Amen. I didn't keep you too long. You are free to go. Have a blessed, blessed day. In Jesus' name.
The kings and their kings.